If you've ever considered getting an electric bike, this might be the one. It's the Troxus Explorer 26-inch fat tire e-bike, and I'm here to tell you all about it today, so stay tuned. E-bikes are definitely coming more and more into fashion, becoming more and more popular, and I feel like the prices are dropping. So if you're thinking about getting your first e-bike, I'd like to approach this video from that perspective of someone who's never had an e-bike before and is just kind of dipping their toe in the water to see what's out there. Now, first of all, I wouldn't call this a mountain bike. This is more of an urban bike. It's got the rack on the back and it came with that. It's got fenders. I'd say it's more of a commuter bike or a bike that you can ride around a park in, over gravel trails, over curbs if you want to, through a little bit of grass, but I wouldn't try to do any serious mountain biking on this thing. But that doesn't mean it's not fun, because it actually is a blast. My entire family has enjoyed riding this for the last 3 weeks since we got it, and they're just all stoked about the fact that we have one and want to get more. Now on the Troxus website, it's listed at $2,300, but it also has a line through that and says on sale for $1,800 or something like that. So I think probably if you see it for between $1,800 and $2,000, that's probably the right price to pay for it. I imagine it's one of those situations where they're on sale pretty frequently. I've ridden some specialized mountain bikes and some other higher end brands, and they are very expensive. Some of the higher end specialized actual mountain bikes that you can do real mountain biking on, like dropping off of ledges and riding technical stuff, are like $10,000, $12,000. So it's a pretty big price difference. And if you're just starting out, I obviously think it's better to start with something a little less expensive, but good quality, and see how you like it first. Now I'm gonna tell you 10 things that I really like about this bike and 4 things that I don't like that much. And you can make up your mind whether it's right for you. I will also tell you this bike is designed for taller people. It says 5'4 to 6'10. I think it's probably somewhere more in the middle, like 5'6 to 6'3 is probably a good range. My son is pretty tall. He's about 6'2, 6'3, and he fits on it just fine. I'm 6'1, 225 pounds, and I fit on it just fine. It's got a pretty big weight limit, and it's got a pretty big limit as far as height goes. It does have a manually adjustable seat with a quick release, which I like. You don't have to get any tools out to adjust the seat. So if my wife wants to ride it, she can drop the seat down to her level, and then if I want to hop in, it only takes a second to raise the seat up to my level and my son to his level. So we've been actually raising the seat up and down a lot because we've all been taking turns riding it. Now let me start with the 10 things that I really like about this bike. The first thing is that it's very solid and seems to be well built. Now I've dropped it off a few curbs, I've taken it up a few curbs, through some grass, through some bumpy areas, across gravel, all that sort of thing, and it's been just fine. The only thing that rattles a little bit are these fenders. And that's understandable because they're fenders. If you really want to be off-road more, you might just consider taking those off. You don't need them. But I do like the look of the fenders, and I do like how they keep mud and stuff from flapping up onto you as you're riding. It does come partially assembled. You have to do a few things to it. I'm actually making a second video where I'm going to show you how to assemble it straight out of the box. I did it. It's better if you have two people, but you can do it with just one person. Probably take you about an hour or so. And it's not that hard to do, but I say it's one of those things that it's good to watch the video if you want to actually buy one of these and put it together. The next thing I love about this bike is the look of it. The color is fantastic. It looks really sharp. We've been riding it quite a bit and it's not really dirty yet because we've mostly stayed on roads, but it just looks really good. People give you kind of a look as you're riding down the street. I like this blue color. I like the accents with the white graphics and stuff. I like the black. I like the black fenders. I like everything about the way this bike looks. And so if you're going for a bike that looks good and rugged, this is a great one. And that's my number 2 thing that I like. Number 3 thing I like about this bike is the little extras, like the light on the front. It's actually a pretty bright LED that you can turn on if you want to have it on during the day for safety, or turn it on in the evening or at night if you're riding in the dark. It also has a quick release, like I said, on the seat. Some of them have require an Allen key. This one doesn't. You can just pull it, raise it, lower it, and push it back in and you're good to go. It's got brake lights in the back. It also has the battery hidden inside, which I like. And there is a key where you can turn and take the battery out if you want to, remove it for any reason. If you need to store it, say it's really cold out in your garage or really hot out in your garage, you want to store the battery inside, you can do that. Lots of little extras on this thing that I really like. And that's my number 3 thing that I like about this bike. The number 4 thing I really like about this bike is the fat, fat tires. Now, I've been riding mountain bikes since the late 80s, and I have never seen tires quite this fat. Actually, I've seen them, I've just never ridden on them. What's nice about them is you can keep a low amount of tire pressure on them. They're fairly squishy, so they give a lot over curbs and stuff like that. Very comfortable to ride on, and you just feel really solid. Turning the handlebar is a little bit harder than a normal bike because there's a little more resistance and there is more rolling resistance, but that's why you got the motor, right? It's just a very fat tire bike. It's also great for going over gravel and sand and stuff like that, which you couldn't really do as easily with thinner tires. So the fat tires are the number four thing I really like about this bike. Now the fifth thing I like about it is the battery life. We've had it for a couple of weeks and we haven't had to charge it that often. As a matter of fact, I told my kids, don't charge it until it gets down to one bar on the battery indicator. And there have been several times when they've gone for a ride, I've gone for a ride, several of us have gone out riding on it, and it's still at half full or a quarter full, and we don't even charge it up at that point. And then the next time we ride it, after that we have to charge it, but it can get 30 to 60 miles of range according to the website. I haven't tested it, but I can tell you it feels like it's going at least 30 miles between charges, and I like that about it. It's a good size battery, and it's gonna give you quite a bit of distance. Now, I wouldn't push it too hard, and I will also say it's gonna really depend on how much you pedal, and it's also gonna depend on how hilly the area that you're riding is. If it's a flatter area, you'll probably get more distance. If there's more hills, like around here, you'll get a bit less as you're trying to truck up hills. If you're just using the throttle all the time, you're gonna be on the low end of that range, but if you're pedaling and using the throttles, or just pedaling with the pedal assist, you'll be on the high end of that range. And speaking of long range, this bike has a Samsung battery. Now, why does that matter? Because I believe that Samsung is a company that has enough R&D and enough money behind it to make good quality batteries and everything else they make. It's not gonna be the absolute best, but you also know it's not an off-brand and it's not a battery that's gonna die in a year or two. Samsung battery technology has come a long way, along with all the other technology that's going into batteries these days. I feel like this battery should be a long-lasting battery because it is a Samsung, and also, like I said, you can take it out if you want to, which gives you the ability to replace it if you needed to down the road. The next thing I really like about this bike is the screen. The screen has useful information like your average speed, your top speed, your current speed. You can switch between kilometers per hour and miles per hour. You can also see how much battery is left. You can see if your light's on or not. It's got a lot of good information, but not too much. It's a simple black and white LCD screen that allows you to see what's going on, but isn't draining the battery a whole lot and isn't overkill. I really kind of can't stand it when things like a bike have a giant breakable screen on them. Now that probably would break in a crash, but it also looks like it's pretty easily replaced. So I'd say the screen is a bonus and a plus that gives you a lot of information from the systems on this bike, tells you all the things you need to know, and that's another thing I like about it. And then to the powertrain. Now this bike has both a throttle and pedal assist, but both of those are powered by a 750 watt motor in the back. And that is a hub motor that's connected to the rear hub, and you don't see it. It's very quiet, has a little bit of a hum when you pedal or when you push the throttle, but it doesn't sound like anything really, just except a hum. This is 750 watts, as I said. Some bikes like this come with 300 or 500 watt motors. Some come with 1,000 watt motors. So this is kind of on the higher end of what's available. And again, for a lower price bike, I believe that 750 watts is probably a good amount for this bike and for the price that you're paying for it. Now, I did try a speed test on this thing to see how fast it would go. They claim it'll go 28 miles per hour, and I was able to achieve that going slightly downhill and pedaling like crazy in the fifth pedal assist mode. I hit maybe even 29 miles per hour, but it took some effort to get up to that, and that was me doing a lot of the work. I'd say if you're my size and weight, you're probably gonna be cruising around 15 to 20 miles an hour pretty easily. And if you're lighter, you might be able to go a little faster. But that's not the point of this. This isn't a racing bike. It's a bike that gets you from point A to point B in style and comfort. Okay, I think I just briefly got it up to 29 going downhill. So that's pretty good. Now the next thing, as I've mentioned before, I feel like the price on this thing is fairly reasonable. It's coming in right around $2,000 plus or minus. You can also get some extra accessories for it that are gonna add to it that are built for this bike. But that price for the quality of this, in my honest opinion, is a good deal. I really think that this bike is something that if you're gonna pay for an electric bike, it's a great place to start. And it's something that you could probably give to a child or to someone else if you wanted to get a better one, a more expensive one, or you could even sell it after the fact and probably get most of your money back. And then of course, the last thing that I'll have to say is this thing is just fun. If you've never ridden an electric bike or an electric skateboard, both those things are a big rush. As a kid, I rode skateboards and rode bikes quite a bit, and to know now that I can do it with that power behind me, it just feels so cool and so awesome. And I can't say enough good things about e-bikes in general. And while this one isn't the best, it doesn't have all the things, and I'm about to get into some of the things I don't like about this bike, it's a really great starting point. So the fun factor is something you should take into account, and from the way it looks and the way it rides, everybody in my family who's ridden it so far has had a lot of fun with it. I also want to point out real quick that if you are thinking about getting an electric bike for yourself or a child or someone else in your family as a gift, this one is street legal and it's treated as a bicycle because it's pedal assist. If a bike has only throttle and no pedals, it could be considered a scooter. It might require a permit or a license or even registration. It might not be legal where all bicycles are. I like this because it is clearly a bicycle. It looks like a bicycle. And so if I'm riding in the bike lane, nobody's gonna think anything of it other than the fact that I'm passing everybody as I go because it's so easy to pedal and I'm cruising up hills really quick. But it's a bicycle, not a scooter or an electric vehicle that requires registration. Keep that in mind when you're looking at e-bikes to get one that is actually considered a bicycle and check the local laws. Now with the good comes some bad and with the low price comes some compromises. So let me tell you four things that I'm not crazy about with this bike. Number one is the weight. This thing is just a beast. It's super heavy. It's not gonna be something you can just throw into the back of a station wagon or an SUV. And you just have to keep that in mind. If you run out of battery and you're trying to pedal and you're trying to pedal uphill without any assistance, it's just so heavy, it's really gonna wear you out. And it's a choice, right? It's a big bomber style bike with huge fat tires and a really thick frame and a big battery and a bigger motor and all that stuff. So it's gonna weigh a lot. And just know that when you get on it and don't expect it to be like a regular bicycle in terms of weight. The second thing I don't like about this bike, and again, this comes from it being less expensive, is the fact that it's kind of on or off as far as the power goes. I've ridden more expensive, specialized electric bikes, and with the pedal assist, if you pedal slowly, it only gives you a little bit of extra power. If you pedal harder, it gives you more. With this one, it just kind of, as soon as you start pedaling, it starts giving you juice. Now there's five levels you can set that at. So you can have it just give you a little bit more, a little bit more, all the way up to five. But it doesn't have that subtlety that a more expensive electric bike's gonna have. So just know that with the pedal assist, you're just gonna basically be pedaling with power or without power. There's no real middle ground there. It's kind of just on or off as you're pedaling. And that's something that I think, again, comes with the fact that it's a cheaper bike. Number three, as I mentioned earlier, the shifters aren't super smooth. The components aren't bad. I believe they're Shimano components, but they're not top-end components by any means. They're fairly inexpensive. You know, it's kind of like what you might get at Academy or Walmart as far as the components go. Will they work? Yes. But are they going to be really smooth shifting if you need to shift from first gear to eighth gear quickly? No. They take a little while, they're kind of clunky, and so just bear that in mind. Typically, I've got the thing just kind of in the middle gear all the time because the pedal assist helps so much. I don't see any need to raise or lower gears to ride it manually since I'm using the pedal assist. But the gears, components, and all of that stuff are decent, but not great. I will say to that point though, it does have disc brakes, and disc brakes are essential. I would never buy a bike with the regular cantilever brakes anymore. That's just outdated, but the disc brakes work really well. I was riding around filming myself using just one hand and one brake, getting going pretty fast, and I was able to stop very confidently with the disc brakes. And my final dislike about this bike that may be a deal breaker for you if you're looking at it is it's not portable. And by portable, I don't mean riding it. I mean putting it into a vehicle or onto a bike rack. It really doesn't fit on bike racks very well. I tried to put it on my bike rack, which I put all kinds of mountain bikes and road bikes on. Never had a problem with the bike fitting on it before. The wheels were too fat. They wouldn't fit in the little grips for it. It was really heavy and hard to get up on the thing. And once I got it up on there, I couldn't get the wheels in and I was kind of frustrated. If you own a pickup truck with a bike rack and you can put it in there, that might be good. So if you're looking at it as a bike for your kids or for someone that they're gonna put it in their car and take it with them camping and stuff like that, it's probably not the right bike. But if you're looking at it as a commuter around your neighborhood or to ride around parks near your house, that sort of thing, or even to commute to work, then it could very well work for those things. So overall, I have to say, if you're looking for an inexpensive, around $2,000 bomber bike that looks great and rides well, consider the Troxus. There are dealers around the United States. If you look on their website, you can see places where you can go ride one, or just go ride an electric bike that a friend has, or just find a dealer that has any electric bike and see what you think. And then if you're looking at the price ranges and the features, You might consider this one, and you might consider some others. I'd love to hear what you think about this bike and about other e-bikes and electric skateboards and all that mode of electric transportation that didn't exist 20 years ago. Leave a comment below, let me know what you think. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time on Ready, Set, Drone.